the statistics on how Gen Z differs from the millennials are not good. So the millennials, the oldest ones were like in college when the internet and then social media came out, whereas the youngest ones grew up with the internet. But the cutoff seems to be that Gen Z, if you were born in 1996 or 97, you might have gotten social media from the time you were in middle school. The millennials didn't get it till college or later. And if you imagine, you know, imagine kids growing up and there's all kinds of inputs coming into them, and then suddenly around 2009 to 2011, in that period, we switch the inputs up so that now everyone is hyper-connected to their peers, massively sharing information among their peers, and evaluating each other, always, you know, clicking likes and evaluating things. This is a really rapid transformation in the fundamental fabric of socialization. And that, Greg Lukianoff and I, my co-author, that's what we think causes the relatively big shift between Gen Z and the millennials. And the shift shows up in very high rates of anxiety, depression, self-harm, and suicide. So my point is, this isn't just, hey, they're different from us and I don't like it. It's, hey, they're different from us and they're having problems that they themselves say, wow, we're having problems. And what we find across countries is that there is a big rise, especially for girls. The boys are doing worse too, but the girls, the increases for girls are much bigger. And it tends to start around 2012, 2013, but we have a lot of data. This is not just changing diagnostic standards. It's not just, oh, you know, Gen Z is so comfortable talking about it that the reported rates go up. It's not that, because it's also how many kids are admitted to a hospital every year because they cut themselves, and it's also suicide. So we know that this is a real trend, and it's a very alarming trend. So there's a lot of research on how boys and girls' social lives are different, and that's been known for a long time. One of the clearest things is that boys and girls are actually equally aggressive. It's not that boys are aggressive and girls are nice. Like, no, not at all. They're equally aggressive. But boys are kind of socially clueless and physically aggressive. Their aggression is what we think of as bullying, physical bullying. But girls' aggression is relational. Girls are much more socially sophisticated. They have clear representations in their minds of everybody's relationships and how to manipulate them. So girls' aggression is social. When social media comes in, or rather when everyone has an iPhone or, you know, smartphone, what do? They stop punching each other and they join small teams to roam around virtual worlds killing other teams, which is actually fun. It's not particularly harmful. My son does it with his friends. It can get addictive, so you've got to put limits on it. But video games aren't nearly as harmful as we thought, and it's debatable how harmful they are. That's one piece. So that affects the boys. But it doesn't make them depressed. And if you think about it, after you do a video game, you go away and you're not replaying it in your mind like, oh God, if only I had shot him in the head. Like, you're not thinking that. Like, you can put it away. But social media is very, very different. So the girls spend a lot more time on social media. They can use it. It can hypercharge their aggression. It gives them the ability to damage other girls' relationships, to spread gossip or rumors or fake photographs, to do it anonymously with full deniability. So now girls can't escape bullying even on the weekends when they're out of school. So it really changes aggression. Also, girls are more sensitive to being left out or excluded. Everyone hates that. But social media lets you know who's where and with whom. And look, they're all having so much fun and I'm not there. So fear of missing out, fear of being left out hits girls harder. So for a variety of reasons, we think, the fact that the girls' rate really begins to shoot up around 2012, 2013 is consistent with the fact that American teenagers and British teenagers really moved online between 2009 and about 2011, 2012. And then right after that, the rates go up. So, you know, I'm very concerned about what social media is doing to political discourse. And places like Twitter are really nasty. I mean, it's a dumpster fire, which is kind of fun to watch sometimes, but I think it's really nasty. Of the main ones that people use, I think Twitter is the most destructive in that way. My wife is on Instagram and she tells me, no, but Instagram's really nice. Like, there's not a lot of that on Instagram. And it turns out that for girls, that actually can be the problem. Not that more nastiness would be better, but what I mean is, if Instagram isn't about, like, you're an idiot, you're a moron, if Instagram is, look at my beautiful life, look at my perfect, you know, my perfect selfie and my hair and my body, well, you know, girls have always been more sensitive to social comparison, especially adolescent girls going through puberty, very sensitive to whether they measure up, how people are judging them. And so to be deluged with photos in which your friends look better than you, your friends look better than they do in real life, that puts a lot of pressure. That's very difficult, especially for preteen and young teen girls. And so in many ways, social media is harder on girls than it is on boys. We can go back to Prometheus here, the story of Prometheus stealing fire from the gods and giving it as a gift to mankind. And obviously fire has done amazing things for us. Thank God we have fire, but you know, it also burns down a lot of things. The founders of social media, the ethos of the tech geniuses was really just, let's just, you know, here's an idea, here's a possibility, here's an interesting thing we can do. Let's put it out there. We'll iterate, we'll just do rounds. And there wasn't a lot of thinking about where it would go wrong, what harm it would do. There was a professor at Stanford who ran the Persuasive Technology Lab. And there's writing from him in the early days about how, of course, these technologies could be misused. But because we think human nature is good, we believe that, you know, this will give people more possibilities. And if we just connect everyone, it'll be great. Well, you know, it's not correct to say human nature is good or evil. Human nature is really complicated. And if you put these tools, you hyperconnect people with the ability to spread lies and gossip, a lot of bad stuff happens. So I think there was very little thought about what they were doing. At least when the original scientists split the atom and created nuclear weapons, they were aware of what they were doing and they were careful about it. There was a lot of crime in America in the 70s and 80s. And we let kids out to play. We expected them to learn how to do things themselves. And what's changed over the years is that the world has gotten a lot physically safer. Kids are safer than they've ever been in history. Very little crime. Cars are safer. Foods are safer. Consumer products are safer. But yet we've become far more paranoid because of changes in the media, because we're now more likely to have only one child or two at most. You know, if you have six children, you can't overprotect them. You got to kind of just, you know, get out of here. Go play in the backyard. So the key to understanding why we've gone wrong and the key to understanding what's happening to Gen Z, I believe, is the concept of anti-fragility. This is the most important idea. I just love this idea. It comes from Nassim Taleb. And so the key idea, and it's so easy to explain, once people get it, oh my God, why am I treating my kids this way? It's that a lot of things in the world are fragile. And so, you know, glass is fragile. And if you drop it, it breaks and it doesn't make it better. So we don't give glass to kids. We give them plastic. Plastic is resilient, we say. If a kid drops it, a cup, it doesn't break, but it doesn't get better. And Taleb wanted to know, what's the word for systems or things that get better when you drop them? When you challenge them, you expose them to disorder and threats and chaos, they get stronger. And the immune system is the perfect example. Your immune system has to have threats and challenges and bacteria and dirt, and even parasitic worms, turns out, helps it develop. And if you deprive your kid of that, you're not helping them, you're weakening them. So once you see that kids are anti-fragile, now you can see how our overprotection is so misguided. Kids learn best from experience, not from parental lectures. And the whole attachment system is supposed to work where the parent provides a secure home base that the kid can come back to if there's danger. But the point of that secure home base is that the kid goes out and explores the world and develops his or her capacities. All mammals play, all mammals do that. When there's a threat, they come back to mom, but when there's not a threat, they're out playing and practicing skills for adulthood. And we used to do that in America up until the 1990s. So I'm a social psychologist who studies culture and evolution. We're an evolved species, our brains were made by a long evolutionary process, but we express ourselves in different ways culturally. And whenever I find a pattern repeated across cultures, I lock on to like, wow, that's really cool. This really tells us something important. And initiation rites is one of those. And so the fact that most cultures, in their earlier states at least, had some sort of initiation rites. So they have them for males and often for females. Cultures that have both, they're always more intense for the male, and some have it for male but not for female. Because many cultures believe girls will turn into women automatically, but boys start off small and weak. They start off being raised by their mothers, and then the men are off doing male stuff. And many cultures believe that unless you do something, a boy doesn't become a man. And so many cultures they'll do rituals that are terrifying, that sort of kill the child, and then the man, it comes out of it. So the fact that so many cultures do it, and the fact that fraternities at universities reinvent almost the same rituals, the fear, the disgust, the humiliation, the physical pain. But it does speak to a deep need in male psychology for something like this. There are cases on campus where somebody got hurt in a snowball fight, so they banned snowball fights for college students, for adults. You're not allowed to have a snowball fight. Super soakers are banned at some schools, you know, water pistol fights. And it's this paranoid mindset, which, again, the subtitle of our book is how good intentions and bad ideas are setting up a generation for failure. It may have been a good intention to shut down fraternity initiations, and there are real harms. I don't want to minimize those. But if you don't understand the psychology of development, especially male development, I think, you're gonna produce some unintended consequences. But I think we are paying for it now in the sense of greater fragility. College students in a fraternity have to be a self-governing society. When you get rid of all that, and so kids are not self-governing until they get to college, and then they're not self-governing in college, and then they go into employment, what I'm finding when I talk to business leaders, and I would urge listeners to do this, if you know people who run businesses where they hire young people, ask them how it's working. I was just in Madrid, and a business person said to me, yeah, you know, I mean, my recent hires, it's like they don't know how to change a light bulb. Like, they can't do anything for themselves. And so we are paying for it in that we have deprived Gen Z of millions of learning opportunities, and then we're surprised that they don't know how to function as we expect them to.
This video is sponsored by Blinkist. Reading books is great, but I've talked about this many times before. Many books are written very inefficiently and should be much, much shorter than they are. Not only that, sometimes you just don't have the time to read a whole book, or you might want to just go back and review the main ideas without reading the whole thing again. This is why I use and recommend Blinkist. It's a great app that takes information from the best books and condenses it to 15 minutes that you can read or listen to. For someone looking to learn, I really think this might be one of the best apps out there right now. I recommend starting with a summary for any book on the Fight Mediocrity Beginner's Reading List, or any of the books that are in my Blinkist library right now. If that sounds good, head over to blinkist.com/fightmediocrity or click the link in the description below. You can give it a try for 7 days completely free, and if you don't want to continue, you can cancel at any time. As a Fight Mediocrity viewer, you'll also get 25% off if you decide you want the full membership. Thanks for watching.